Good morning, all of you. I hope I am audible. Actually, I have nothing to do with science. Except for the spelling, I do not know anything about science. So, please don't ask me questions on science. This PPT is only for my own memory. I hope. My name is, I'm Devki. I have a master's in psychology and linguistics. Both of them nothing to do with science directly. Doctoral degree in psychology. I have been working in the area of language, education, and thinking for over 20 years, then shifted to Azimpin University. Currently, I head the Department of Research at Azimpin University. What I say will make more meaning if I talk to you about Azimpin University. I invite you to make small gears in your thinking. So Azim Premji University, before the establishment of Azim Premji University, I was a part of Azim Premji Foundation. The foundation has been in existence since 2001. Is it necessary for me to hold this? Good, okay. Okay. So everything that we do is defined by our vision, by a specific purpose. And the purpose is the following. When I just articulate the purpose, it may seem very abstract and sort of even meaningless and ridiculous. But let me just articulate it because we are fond of doing it. We would like to look at us contribute to a society that's equitable, that's sustainable, that has justice, and that's humane. If you look at each one of these are not our vision. In fact, these are a part of the Constitution. But everything that we do, we sort of constantly discuss, and by design, we ensure that it contributes to the purpose. So everything that we do, we constantly keep this question, ask this question, is it equitable? Does it contribute to an equitable society? Does it contribute to a sustainable society? So these are things that are very, very important when we come to the domain of education. So let me just give you an example. Which do you think is an endangered species? Which is an endangered species, at least in India? Tiger? Answer is no. It's our local cow. Surprised, isn't it? Cow. Our local cow is an endangered species. So let me just give you a brief research finding on how cow is the local endangered species. So we used to have our local cows, and then somebody said, let's look, sort of import Jersey cows. So as a matter of policy, we got a lot of Jersey cows imported. Jersey cows produce a lot of milk. So they said it will take care of all our needs for milk. So let's get Jersey cows. We got Jersey cows. In the process, we neglected our local cows. What happened? Year one, Jersey cows had a lot of food. So the ratio of intake of a local cow versus Jersey cow is 1:4 fodder. So where we are spending 1%, we are spending 4%. Jersey cows could not adapt to our environment. Jersey cows Year one produced lot of milk. Year two, milk production decreased. Year three, sickness. So now we have landed ourselves in a situation where we do not have our local cows. We have a sort of a burden in the name of Jersey cows. So what's happening at a deeper level? When you look at it, in the name of equity and efficiency, we have gone for efficiency model. A model which says efficient, more efficient, higher the productivity. Ignoring a very basic concept, resilience. Anything that adapts to the environment is more resilient than efficiency. So this is just to give you a glimpse of the issues that we grapple with in the area of sustainable development, in the area of ecology, in the area of education as such. So we are spread across 9 states, and in each of this, we work with the government. We are not interested in setting up alternate systems or small islands of excellence because we believe in equity. One challenge that we experienced when we were working as a foundation was we did not have people to work at the grassroots, people to work with teachers, people to work in schools, people to help children learn, people who would help administrators guide them through how to manage this big system of education. And so the whole idea of university was born. As in Premji University, so we deliberately choose people who have a commitment and a passion to work in this space. So these are the two primary and essential requirements for us to work in this space. Even when we select our students, it's not how much marks they have got in their undergraduate course. It is the amount of commitment, amount of passion they are willing to invest in. And that's the basis for our selection. Even when we look at our curriculum, it's sort of designed the same way. When we engage with stakeholders, it's the same principle. And even in our own work, we do something similar. So basically, the university, we have degree programs. We have only 2 degree programs as of now, MA in Education and MA Development. We do not propose to start any other kinds of degree programs. We will be starting an undergraduate program. Research is an area where I work in. So basically, it is to fund research within the organization. And even research, we are not interested in research that contributes to libraries, that contributes to journal publications. We are interested in research that impacts human beings. We are interested in research that's relevant for our lives. So this is not to degrade or devalue academic research. It is to say that we need to all research cannot be academic research. We need to correct the balance. Any subject can become important only when it has value and relevance to human life. So in that sense, there's a whole lot of knowledge waiting to be explored, waiting to be discovered, which has relevance to us. And it is those kinds of research that we publish, that we encourage. We are not interested in, communication. We are interested in the content. So this is, again, not to say that communication is wrong, is bad. Please don't get me wrong. These are important. But what you say, what a student says, what a teacher says is more important. We will flesh out the communication part. That's the way we look at things. We would like to influence practice. So we have opportunities in all these domains. One of our most important guiding principle is we do not work alone. We always work as teams, because we believe competition should not be encouraged. We grow together. We believe in collaboration. We believe in cooperation. This morning also the point was made that there's a difference between career and jobs. As my earlier speaker, if you're interested in getting rich, this is not the space for you. It's essential that anyone who joins the university look at it as a career rather than a job. In the sense, it's a 24/7. And please believe me, it's really 24/7 job where you can get calls from teachers saying, look, I don't know how to teach this topic. Or calls from kids. Calls from any part at any time. We also... Have I done it right? Okay. So commitment, as I said, is a very, very important, essential requirement to join the university or the foundation. Second is the subject matter competence. Skills. We believe that everyone is a leader. There's no such thing as somebody. So we distinguish between leadership, a positional leadership versus a functional leadership. And we go with the philosophy of functional leadership. We believe everyone has to take initiative and has to become leader. Let me just give you an example of why this is important. So when you talk to teachers, or when you talk to anyone in the government, they say that, look, I obey the orders. That's it. So they constantly operate in this compliance mode. Even as a child, we enforce that children operate in the compliance mode. When they come to college, it's the same kind of education. Again, when they go to their jobs, it's the same kind of work. Have I? Okay. It's the same kind of work. So compliance mode. We want to sort of develop a mode of working which is non-compliant, which questions, which critiques everything, irrespective of age, experience. And so leadership, facilitation skills, how you say. So this is again linked to communication. How you say, what you say is important. How you say it is also important. So when in a job profile, we look at all these things. First is the commitment, the extent of commitment or the passion, your subject matter competence, and third, the skill. Okay, how do you prepare yourself? Actually, we do not look at any specific preparations as such. As long as you have the commitment, as long as you're aware of the problems that the country is facing, the difference between the haves and the have-nots, the kind of learning problems that children face. For instance, you'd be surprised to know that even teachers in rural schools do not make a distinction between breathing and respiration. They have wrong notions of what a heart is used for. What's the purpose of a heart? How does it function? So some knowledge about what are the broad areas of misconceptions. How do children learn biology? Understanding of this and an understanding of how schools function would be desirable, but not necessary. We do not look for a doctoral degree to be an essential qualification, but it helps. Okay, compensation. Sorry, I cannot reel out figures like 60,000 and such things. It basically depends on what you bring to the table as well as the parity. Because, as I said, we believe in an equitable organization, so it depends on how much others are getting as well. Opportunity for growth, immense. By immense, I mean that every day is a new day. Every day you get diversity of experiences. Every day you sort of listen to different languages. For instance, here I am talking in English. Tomorrow, I'll be hearing Hindi, talking to teachers. Every day is a new experience, and the opportunity to grow is immense. And this is a space where everything is guided by philosophy of the nature of human beings. Philosophy of how things ought to be rather than how things are. Are there adequate jobs in the field? Yes, at least in my view. We are 674 districts. We are present in, we hope to be present in 50 districts by 2017, and we hope to increase our presence. In addition, we have had three batches of students. All the students have been placed. So we have various tie-ups with NGOs who are also working in a space like ours. That's it. I hope to see at least some of you. That's it. Thank you.
I have a question, actually. So what specific chances do you see, what specific opportunities do you see for people interested, not in this field, not specifically with Azim Premji Foundation itself or the university itself, but in general? I mean, you said 600, there are 674 districts, but you yourself are placed only in about 20 of them. If one were to, be interested in joining the science communication field or education field, how would one go about it?
A smaller audience. We have the experience that you cannot train teachers with one or two training programs. So a constant presence is very, very essential. So if you have to work in this space, the best thing is to either lodge yourself in a particular place and work in schools, or with teachers or with whomsoever is your stakeholder. Or the other thing is to join any non-governmental organization or start your own organization. But it's, if you begin your work with an organization, it's easier to get entry into schools.
Actually, I also have a follow-up question. So is it, in your opinion, doable, possible to do this on a part-time basis, you know, for someone with the skill set here, okay, if they wanted to contribute, would it be possible for them to spend a certain amount of time per week, say, helping out in this field? Is that doable? Is that a practical approach?
Immediately, no. For the simple reason, we are not present in Bangalore as such. I mean, we have our office and such things, but once we have started our work in Kodathi, I don't know if how many of you are aware of it, of this particular place, it's beyond Sarjapur. Once we sort of become very functional, then we would like some sort of voluntary work, internships and such things. Thanks for bringing that up. In fact, this was an important slide I missed. Some of the opportunities in our own organizations are you could join as faculty teaching the undergrad program, or you could do a specialized courses. In addition, you could also contribute to teacher training or develop assessment tools. So we are present. Generally, we work, most of our works are in field, in the nine places that I mentioned. So there you work with teachers, you work with students, you work with functionaries. We have a fellowship program that's specifically meant for people who are interested in trying out this space after, let's say, 2 to 6 years of experience. We also have a campus program that's just meant for people who want to take a break from the study and sort of exploring what they want to do. Thank you.